It's finally time for the last battle of the Masters Division here at the Oceania International Championships. Your first trainer coming all the way from Portugal, it's Eduardo Cunha. And his opponent making the long trip all the way across Australia, Luke Curtale. All right, trainers, let's shake hands and have a good match. Good luck, have fun. Adam and Lou, back to you.
Both trainers looking pretty excited about this one. Big smiles over on both sides as they settle in for the final game here in Melbourne, the final game of their tournament and the final game overall for this weekend.
Yes, I was sitting with them while we were watching the seniors finals together, and both of them, they're, you know, calm, cool and collected. But the one thing they were saying is together they've kind of built this team up to what it is for their individual players. So apparently originally it was Eduardo's team, and Luke and him, as good friends, as you do with your team building buddies, sort of took the team, adapted it to his own play style, and both Eduardo and Luke know exactly what the other players got. They've sort of practiced together, they've been able to build it to their own style. So not only do you have to play against the same six Pokemon, you also are very knowledgeable in how your opponent plays that team.
Yeah, I mean, looking at the teams, obviously identical six, but there are some tweaks from each player,
yes,
maybe towards their own style. And if you look at the teams on paper, it kind of becomes one of the most expensive games of spot the difference I've ever been forced to play. The odd move here, the odd kind of difference in the training, really minor adaptations from these players from obviously what was a shared start,
yes,
just to see where they go.
And particularly when those moody rolls start happening, you need to be able to keep track of what is keeping these two players' teams completely separate. You can see Eduardo here, number one seed, 9-0 record, and all the accolades underneath him there. You can see that he has top 16, many international championships, and back in 2016, he topped for the world championship. So a very, very formidable opponent here, rocking these amazing six Pokemon on the right.
Yeah, and he's always been well known for, you know, working with many other players,
yes,
and talking about teams, figuring out those optimal strategies. So it's got to be feeling pretty good, you know, if he's the originator of this team. He may have, you know, even if it's a couple weeks more experience, that may help him out over Luke here. So that's something that he's going to be thinking, well, I built this. I know how this comes together. And Luke's team, it's in a different order. We shuffled them up for you a little bit there. But they are going to be the same six Pokemon. His achievements, not too shabby either. The top eight and the top four that you mentioned earlier on. And the same before the international circuit started when it was just a national championship there, making top eight there. So one of the strongest trainers from this region.
Very true. And it's all going to come down to what four Pokemon these players are going to lead out against each other. And I feel like that Smeargle and that Xerneas that you've seen on both these player cards here are going to play very crucial roles. We sort of mentioned Smeargle and the moody roles, but crucially that lovely kiss as well. Not the most accurate of moves, whether it's going to be able to land on the opponent's Pokemon and start putting the board into your player's favor is going to be interesting to see. And also that Xerneas, it's going to come down to how they have built it, I think, Adam.
Yeah, I mean, there's going to be a whole lot of tracking each other's moody boost. We do see Eduardo with his pen and paper ready to go there. I think that's going to be key, making sure that he knows what's going on there. We saw a couple games yesterday where the moody boosts were certainly interesting.
Yes.
And I think both trainers will be hoping they can get the benefit of those boosts themselves, those evasiveness boosts, those speed boosts, those accuracy boosts for the benefit of Lovely Kiss as well. Those are the ones you want, and those are the ones you don't want on the flip side getting decreased either. So both trainers are going to be tracking the end of those turns when Smeargle's on the field with real beady eyes.
That Lunala as well is going to be a cheeky little option. Of course, if Lunala is built at max speed, you're going to be looking at these sort of speed ties going on here. And if they are holding that Lunalium Z, which we know that they are indeed, then that's going to be picking up KOs if your Lunala is able to move first and foremost. So you need to make sure that you're using your Pokemon if you're going for that Smeargle and using the redirection as accurately as possible.
Yeah, and the Lunala speed tie is one of the most interesting mechanics, in my opinion. Not because it's, you know, inherently kind of overcomplicated, but it's more of a mind game for the players. If you've both got your Lunala on the field, do you play it safe and switch it out? Or do you just go for it and hope you win? It's one of those buttons you press kind of with the shaky hand, like, oh, that works. And just to see if you can, A, move first and land the knockout, and hopefully not get punished, you know, for it. It's going to be a tough one in every instance.
If you can get a psych up off as well before you fire that out, you know, then you get the speed advantage on your side. But we can see the players here shaking hands. They've shaked hands with the judges. Everybody here is ready to get into this Masters Grand Final here in the video game at the Pokemon Oceania International Championships.
Yep, the last one of the game should be a good one. We do see Luke's lead first. Stakataka and Smeagol. Is it going to be mirrored on the other side? Smeagol and Lunala. So at least we're not getting the same leads in this one. Stakataka does bring the Trick Room option, which could certainly change things around, depending if they're knowledgeable about that. But it's not that you can just set it up and imagine Eduardo can't capitalize on it, because he also has that option on his team, quite simply.
Yes, and there's two Smeagol on the field as well. And the one thing that Eduardo's got in his favor is if he went for Fake Out, it could go into that Stakataka. Lunala's protected being a ghost type, but instead, it's going to be Crafty Shield coming up there, protecting his partner Lunala, that's just going for a Moongeist Beam here. Going to save his Lunalium Z for later on when it can get that powerful Z move off, potentially against the opposing Lunala or the Xerneas. But you can see how much it does to the opposing Stakataka, which does go for Trick Room. And of course, Crafty Shield there on Eduardo's side, saving him from the lovely kiss. So no one's sleeping early on in this game.
Yeah, Crafty Shield, definitely a conservative play there, making sure that you're safe from the opposing Smeagol. Evasiveness down on Luke's side, so maybe a little harder to hit. Defense up on Eduardo's side, and his accuracy down, so his lovely kiss, which already isn't the most accurate move, a little bit harder to hit now if he does decide to kind of switch it up and get away from just defending himself with the Crafty Shield. Trick Room is, of course, in play, though, and the Stack Attacker has a kind of nasty option in just moving first and seeing what Rock Slide does. Never a fun one if you're on the receiving end of it, and always a bit of a gamble if you're the one trying to use it for your own benefit as well.
Of course, but you do have to worry about that Smeagol going for something potentially like a wide guard and stopping that Rock Slide. But it's going again for the Crafty Shield, wants to make sure that the Lunala does not get put to sleep. It is Rock Slide coming out from the opposing Stack Attack. It does connect on both Pokemon. And will Lunala get flinched? That is the question. It does not, and it goes for the Psyshock, targeting down this opposing Smeagol, going to bring it down to its Focus Sash. So only one more hit is needed, as long as it can hit, of course, to remove that Smeagol from play.
Yeah, well, the Smeagols are going to reveal nice and obviously that they're tied. Boosts that really don't matter on Eduardo's side over there. The defense going up, not really too much of a concern when you're in a Focus Sash, and special attack going down. So nothing of note in the Moody Boost of that turn. But I think Eduardo, you know, wants to get rid of that Smeagol. He doesn't want to just be Crafty Shielding himself. I think he's going to keep doing that until he knows he can start maybe going for lovely kisses of his own with no threat of Crafty Shield on Luke's side as well.
Well, Lunala's switching out here. It's had its Shadow Shield broken, but he wants to preserve it for later on in the game, maybe when Trick Room has gone back to normal. Incineroar coming in here, which is going to be good, getting that Intimidate off against the Stack Attacker, so these Rock Slides and Gyro Balls are not going to be dealing as much damage. But again, Smeagol here, almost pretending like it is a choice Pokemon here, going for the Crafty Shield once again. Rock Slide does come out, would deal good damage against that Incineroar if it had not been intimidated, as Smeagol goes for that lovely kiss, once again being fooled by that Crafty Shield.
Yeah, Luke's just trying to get that. I don't know if that's something he just wants to keep going with.
Yeah, there's been a speed drop on Luke's side, but an evasiveness boost up on Eduardo's side there. So he's still at minus one accuracy, but the evasion there, that could be crucial, particularly as Rock Slide is not the most accurate.
Yeah, and that's something that, you know, maybe his Smeagol can just stick around once he gets through the opposing Smeagol, which, quite honestly, he could do with the fake out. Doesn't have to worry about the speed tier there. Just take that Smeagol out, knowing that that's an option. You know, then you're just... If you're Luke, you've just got Stack Attacker kind of wearing things down, and it's not going to do that anymore after that Intimidate.
Yes, he wants to switch it out, bring it back in when it doesn't have that Intimidate hindering its attack stat, and brings in its own Incineroar. We've seen this so much throughout the entire tournament here in Oceania, where Incineroar's constantly being switched in and out. And we've actually got the mirror here at the moment of Smeagol and Incineroar. The Smeagol on Luke's side, though, not going for these lovely kisses anymore, goes for a Crafty Shield, and will stop Eduardo going for a lovely kiss of his own. That Smeagol, however, has been successfully removed from the field by the Incineroar on Eduardo's side, that is going to return right back to his trainer, giving Eduardo the opportunity to bring in another Pokemon here that might benefit better in Trick Room.
Yeah, I think that's going to be important if he's got his own Stack Attacker, which he does. It's going to love that Trick Room, and being up against the opposing Incineroar. Smeagol does go for a lovely kiss on Eduardo's side, and that crafty shield very important in the end for Luke, meaning his Incineroar stays awake. Eduardo's the only Smeagol in play, not looking too keen on the fact he got that drop off Moody.
No, he does still have plus one evasion though, as he did get the boost previously, but having that extra points in there, particularly when you're in the grand final and things are this intense, you want to make sure you've got as much evasion as possible.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not getting hit, you're able to do so much more with the Smeagol. More lovely kisses, more turns to crafty shield if you think that's something you need to do in that turn. So certainly a good position, I think, for Eduardo's. And it's not too easy to knock out right now, of course. But, you know, it's not down on its focus sash like Luke's was earlier on. The Incineroar, though, did just come in for Luke in the previous turn, so he does have that option to maybe buy a little bit of time. And while he's facing a stack attacker in the trick room he set up, buying time is going to be very important for him there.
Exactly. And we saw how previously the Lunala on Eduardo's side could deal a good amount of damage to the opposing stack attacker with Moongeist Beam. So the stack attacker on Eduardo's side is not going to be safe from that Lunala. So Eduardo wisely switching out here, bringing in Incineroar that's not only going to be able to apply some Intimidate to the opposing Incineroar, but isn't going to worry necessarily about taking a Moongeist Beam or the Z move either. The opposing Incineroar, of course, in Trick Room going first here, going for the Flare Blitz into that Smeagol, isn't enough to pick up the KO thanks to the Intimidate and I believe some defense boost as well. Ooh. But Lunala avoids. It was minus one accuracy, so it was a risk on Eduardo's side as Lunala just goes for Moongeist Beam.
Yeah, and I think just getting some damage down, quite important here. I mean, it's not going to be too much on the Incineroar, but at least he's doing something in the final turn of Trick Room. Smeagol's Moody coming through. Special defense up and speed down. So with the Trick Room ending, that's the worst time to see a speed down drop on your Smeagol on this side. Of course, Eduardo does have the benefit of the fresh Incineroar. Not healthy, but just entered the field. So fake out an option for him there on the opposing Incineroar.
Yes, he could go for a fake out here and stop the opposing Incineroar from going for any moves here. But you could also try and target down that Lunala a little bit more. Just maybe go for some sort of dark type move just to break that Shadow Shield, even just U-turn on out of there so you can come back in later on. The Smeagol going to retreat from Eduardo's side. I mean, being at minus one accuracy and speed, not the best Smeagol on the field. You can bring it back in later to get that reset. The Incineroar, though, on Eduardo's side, just got a hard switch and bring Stack Attacker right back into the action here as Lunala goes for Psyshock. So just preserving up its item at the moment and that target into the Lunala that switched in here. Obviously not going to be very effective. It was not a Moongeist Beam going into that slot as the Incineroar on Luke's side as well goes for U-turn and switches back out. So both these players conserving their Incineroar for later in the game.
Yeah, they find it so, so important. And it has been. I mean, the usage is such a high number over the course of this tournament. But just a really solid switch there from Eduardo. He doesn't really get punished for it, and he gets a board position he wanted that Luke is actually just going to match right now with a stack attacker of his own. The only big difference, you know, there's damage on both sides, but here we have Lunala on Eduardo's side with its Shadow Shield already broken, which may change that decision-making process for Luke. Of course, on the flip side, the stack attacker over on Luke's side already taken a good amount of damage here, so he has to be a little bit careful of that. You know, the Pokemon advantage is still in Eduardo's favor, and that may be something he's going to be able to try and capitalize on in the next few turns.
Of course, and both trainers have brought the same four Pokemon out of their six to this game, showing that they've clearly adapted the same strategy going forward, and both still have their Incineroars safely in the back. We can see the Incineroar on Luke's side jumping out here. So both stack attackers, of course, have to worry about taking these Intimidates and negating some of the big damage that it can deal out with Rock Slide, while Lunala, not affected by these Intimidates, will be able to fire back with some special attack damage. Stack attacker on Eduardo's side getting on out of there, bringing in his own Incineroar. So two switches coming up here, but most crucially, Luke's stack attacker, as long as it's not some kind of double switch going on here, will be intimidated going forward into this turn.
Yeah, I mean, there's no way that they can get rid of that kind of intimidate this time. The menacing Moonray's Maelstrom is about to come from Eduardo's Lunala, and the targeting is going to be huge here. Luke having a little chuckle, seeing if he can fish for the information before the animation confirms it, to see if that Incineroar switch in is going to be big for him. See how well it can deal with that in comparison to the Lunala, which was previously in that slot.
Yeah, it's going into that Incineroar, and it's very similar to what you were saying in the pregame there, Adam. When you've got the Lunala versus Lunala, do you press that button? Do you risk going for it? Obviously with the speed ties and everything, but also if there's that Incineroar in the back that can switch in, that's an added risk that you have to consider. And that's exactly the trap that Eduardo has fallen into here. The Incineroar, of course, taking that like an absolute champ, not very effective damage at all. A Stack Attacker does go for the Gyro Ball here. Gonna target down the Lunala with the Shadow Shield broken. Does do a good amount of damage, but it does survive the turn.
Yeah, it does get to stick around, but it's already used its Z move as well. That Incineroar switching, really big there for Luke. You know, getting rid of your opponent's Menacing Moonrays Maelstrom without kind of giving up too much. Really, really nice there, of course. Eduardo did manage to get his Incineroar in, though, and that helping out the Intimidate. Important against both of Luke's Pokemon, and his came in after because it was a switch for the Stack Attacker. Mm-hmm. So both Incineroar and Stack Attacker taking drops to their attack, which they're not going to appreciate as they try and push Luke through in this game.
Of course, and with the Stack Attacker in the back as well, that's something Luke does have to worry about as his Pokemon's health is dwindling down. The Lunala on Eduardo's side is going to switch up, bring that Stack Attacker back into the action. There isn't too much that either of Luke's Pokemon can do to Stack Attacker at the moment, so it is quite a safe switch in unintimidated. Fake Out going into that Incineroar as well to stop it U-turning out potentially and able to utilize its ability and Fake Out going forward. But Incineroar, having faked out into the opposing Kitty Cat, has been KO'd by the Stack Attacker by a critical hit. And is actually going to return to Eduardo. So now it kind of evens up the playing field here.
Yeah, I mean, it helps out the numbers, and Luke gets the defense boost on his own Stack Attacker, which I'd rather not see it, to be quite honest with you, Lou. But if we come down to a Stack Attacker on Stack Attacker match, that's definitely going to help in what is going to be one of these slower, grindy games here. The big thing to note, though, Smeargle is in right now. It's not got any boosts because it lost them when Moody came into play, but it is going to have its pick of the targets with a potential lovely kiss here. No drops or changes to its accuracy, so maybe a little more likely to hit it this time, unlike the last time it went for it.
That's the thing, you could go for the lovely kiss here and just try and shut down one of the opposing Pokemon. Smeargle's such a pesky little Pokemon, and once it gets those boosts up again, it could put Eduardo into a great position to kind of shake this game around. You do, of course, have to worry about some potential switches here on Luke's side. If he's able to get that Incineroar back out and back in again, you can easily pick up the KO on that Smeargle with something like a Fake Out, but Eduardo really taking his time here. Going down to the last couple of seconds, this is the grand finals, and Smeargle goes for the lovely kiss. It knows it's in finals. It knows it's on stream and does connect onto the opposing Incineroar.
Yeah, this one lands on Incineroar, and that's going to be quite good. Something on Eduardo's side going to be a lot safer from those big attacks. The Stack Attacker on Eduardo's side does go first. Does not land damage on Luke's Stack Attacker, but gets enough to knock out the Incineroar. And we're going to see Luke, I imagine, retaliate in a very similar fashion. That does match up the Beast Boosts now. So Stack Attacker's defense also nice and high. The Smeargle avoiding the Rock Slide there. That was the one I think you wanted to hit.
Oh my gosh, Smeargle here really showing why it is here in the grand finals. It also gets an evasion boost. Drops his accuracy a little bit, but that evasion could be critical, particularly if it's able to start redirecting some of the Lunala's attacks that Luke is now forced to bring in.
That's going to be a nightmare. You're trying to hit that thing. You've already missed it once without an evasion boost, and now it got a sharp rise to its evasion. Stack Attacker is going to have an absolute Western trying to hit this Smeargle with a Rock Slide. I mean, it's not even concerned about the opposing Stack Attacker, so we'll just see if it can get there. You know, we've seen crazier things. I saw a plus six evasion Smeargle take a hit yesterday, and that must be pretty relieving when you get to land that. But this Smeargle still going to be in a position to just kind of keep lovely kissing if it's not knocked out. And it's going to be hard to knock it out because it's going to be hard to hit.
Yeah, Lunala going for the Psyshock here. Is it tucked in at the Smeargle?
Oh,
it is. So Lunala sort of saying, Smeargle, I'm going to ignore your evasion boost here. Go back to your trainer. Leave me just this sort of Stack Attacker on the field at the moment. Going to go for the Gyro Ball, though. This is going to break that Shadow Shield on Lunala finally. It's quite late in the game with Lunala still at full health, but that Stack Attacker took nothing, even from a single target Rock Slide.
I mean, if we get to Stack Attacker versus Stack Attacker with defense boosts, it's going to be a tickling contest. We're going to see if they're going to put themselves in that position. We've finally got ourselves to this Lunala versus Lunala situation that we talked about.
Yes.
And it is going to be a little bit treacherous, seeing if somebody maybe decides to play it safe, keep it nice and safe with a Protect, or just let it happen. You've got to remember, though, Eduardo doesn't have access to his Z move. So even if he Protects, and Luke goes for it with the Z move. He's going to do damage and through the protect and get the knockout, so he may be forced to just try and win the tie. Luke's Lunala with the protect, even though it still has access to that Z move.
Yeah, it wants to just scout it out a little bit, see if maybe he could burn the protect on Lunala for some other reason. If you went for your Z move, it would KO at that range, I believe. But actually going to be KO'd by the Gyro Ball there, going straight into the Lunala, meaning that Stack Attacker is going to get another Beast Boost. So maybe that was a strategy there, just in case we end up seeing Stack Attacker versus Stack Attacker. You want the one that's got a bigger defense boost on its side.
Yeah, Stack Attacker on Eduardo's side does set up a Trick Room here. It's going to be the Stack Attacker's moving first. I don't know how well this Lunala's going to fare against the Stack Attacker on Eduardo's side. So we'll see how the end game comes together. I'm certainly on the edge of my seat right now to see if we're going to be in a position where I need to get more comfortable. But Luke does have access, of course, to the Menacing Moonraise Maelstrom. So Stack Attacker on Eduardo's side can't knock it out. He can at least go back with some big damage. He tries to protect once again.
Yes, that's the thing.
Avoiding it. The Gyro Ball, enough.
It does pick up the KO. That was the thing. Luke's Lunala was the only kind of damage dealer out here on the field at the moment. It did still have access to its Z move. Even without it, though, it could just start dealing out some Moongeist beams. We've seen how much damage that can actually do to a Stack Attacker, assuming that these players have built them relatively similarly. But now we do have the situation of Stack Attacker versus Stack Attacker, and Adam, I saw another defense boost here, so it's quite an equal playing field.
It's a very level playing field, and these Pokemon are going to struggle to hit each other for any significant damage.
I mean, it might come down to struggle in the end.
How comfortable are you in your seat? Because I'm going to tell you, I'm just settling in for this one. There is, of course, a slight health advantage over on Eduardo's side. And it looks like these players are going to be very cautious about their PP in this one. Stack Attacker on Luke's side attempting to rock slide, and no damage because of the protect over on Eduardo's side. We're in for a thriller.
Well, you do still have to look at some variables here. Obviously, you've mentioned there's PP on all of these moves, and you want to be able to preserve that correctly. The move choice here that they're going for is that rock slide. It's not the most accurate of moves, so you do have to kind of account for if your opponent's maybe going to miss a few, and that saves you the extra couple of hit points. And it is literally a couple of hit points that's going to be coming off if these rock slides are able to connect. And then, of course, you have to factor in critical hits. So if they're going to get a few of those, that can also put your player at an advantage. But you mentioned sort of the health status that we've got here at the moment. Saying everything goes to plan, no critical hits, connects every single time. It looks like they'll just whittle away at each other, and then Eduardo will come out victorious. But
this is going to, even if they do start hitting each other when they're not protecting or trick rooming, it is going to be an absolute wet noodle fight. There's not going to be any significant damage coming out of it anytime soon. Like you say, unless we get some critical hits to ignore those defense boosts, and then in the end, it really could come down to something like those rock slide flinches. You know, I think Luke would probably need one or two more in that instance, and I think Eduardo's going to be very smart. You don't want to take unnecessary damage in this instance. But the Trick Room's completely null and void. These Pokemon are at the exact same speed. Really not a problem. There's one. There's a hit.
Yeah, and it just did a tiny bit of damage. Stack Attacker also going for a rock slide.
Go on, my son.
It does just a tiny, tiny amount. Not very effective. We're going to have to start seeing some critical hits or avoids or a little bit of action here.
Go on. Big hits. That's what we want from the Stack Attackers. It's going to be a slow one. Luke took damage last turn. Not again. Not on my watch.
No.
A protect on this side. A failed protect over on Eduardo's side.
Thing is, even if your protect fails, that is using up some PP.
Yeah, I mean, it's still going to be a PP out over on Eduardo's side. And you've got to imagine, based on the fact they shared so much information, it is identical numbers. So it's really whose Stack Attacker has attacked more.
Yeah, exactly. That's going to be the kind of endgame situation here. You can see it from both the players as well. They're kind of having a laugh. They know that they're both playing the same strategy. And I don't know if it's translating to you guys on stream, but back in the crowd, we can hear them all laughing along and kind of getting behind
the
player.
Oh, there it is!
There's a flinch. A little bit of an excitement here from the Stack Attacker. Does flinch, putting Eduardo's at an even stronger advantage.
Yeah, Eduardo's got a much bigger advantage in this one. Not only has he managed to land a couple of rock slides, but he's got flinches as well. It's going to be a big one.
That's what we need from Stack Attacker, and Eduardo's one one here is sort of going, come on, it's game one. Let's jump into game two. I'm going to flinch you and actually connect onto the rock slide. So Trick Room coming up or down again. I'm not too sure what time zone we're in at the moment with Trick Room.
I mean, we are in the Southern Hemisphere, which I know is confusing for both of us. Stack Attacker on Luke's side goes first. Rock slide. Oh, ooh. Is he going to get it?
No critical hit,
no.
But no, it's going to be another rock slide coming out from Stack Attacker. Does connect and keeps chipping away. The Stack Attacker on Luke's side in that yellow, whereas Eduardo's is still nice and healthy in the green.
Oh, it's going to require a lot from Luke, I think. And if we get down to struggle, you do need that, you know, advantage.
You really do.
You want to make sure as well you're not wasting rock slides early on. So both these players, you know, only rock sliding very infrequently. A lot of use of the Protect, a lot of use of the Trick Room as well. I mean, in the end, it could just come down to, you know, who has an extra Rock Slide, who gets that extra flinch, because you really want to be using Rock Slide a little bit more than you do Gyro Ball.
Yeah, that's the thing. Gyro Ball's kind of going to be the backup attacking move at the moment. You need to be able to go through all of the PP of all four moves to be able to access that struggle, which, let's be honest, Adam, is going to be the damage dealing move of choice for these stack attackers.
When you come to a point where you're really hoping you can get down to struggle range, that's what you want. Another Rock Slide lands from Eduardo, keeping up the advantage. Stack Attacker on Luke's side.
Goes for that Gyro Ball. It was listening.
He could be forced into it. It is really not a glamorous amount of damage.
No, Stack Attacker easily able to take that Gyro Ball. It's going to be an indication if maybe Luke is out of these rock slides, goes for the Gyro Ball, does absolutely minimal damage as Eduardo still just clicks that Trick Room button. So just wanting to make everything a little bit jazzy on this Masters video game field.
Well, don't forget, we did see Luke's Stack Attacker in the game earlier as well.
Yes.
So it came in, so it did, of course, use some there.
Oh, it avoids! It had another rock slide in there, goes for the avoid as it takes a little bit of chip damage from that Gyro Ball once again. So Luke's Stack Attacker here not looking too pretty.
I don't want to call it early. I know you're all sat on the edge of your seat for this one, but I think Eduardo's is definitely in the advantage here. A solid 6 hit points dealt by that rock slide as it does flinch. So maybe this is Luke's way back in, 6 hit points at a time.
The best part was Eduardo was the one who reacted very positively there, sort of putting his hand up in the air.
Oh, here we go.
Another Gyro Ball comes down. 4 hit points only. A Stack Attacker is able to go for a Trick Room. No flinch chance from that Gyro Ball, Adam.
Not a chance. And I mean, Luke's is still at a severe disadvantage in the health kind of race to the bottom here. The opposing Stack Attacker, meaning Luke's, coming in with Rock Slide. Oh, another 6 damage. And no
flinch. Goes for a Trick Room. Another thing to kind of consider while we're sort of going through this end game situation, we all sort of know how it's going to play out with between these Stack Attackers. But have a little look at the clock. We're almost down to 50% time in game one. It doesn't look to be wrapping up within the next 5 minutes or so.
Well, you also, the interesting thing as well is, you know, Luke is obviously trying to keep himself up in this game, but every time he flinches his opponent, he doesn't get to move, so he still has another kind of power point available. Big rock slides being exchanged.
Yeah.
Never seen so much damage on the field.
It's almost like Landorus is here, but he didn't make it into these grand finals. Stack Attacker's having to pull up the reins and go for Rock Slide, which is a move that is very harmonious with the video game championships. We talk about it quite a lot. When there is a Rock Slide, there is a way. And in this case, you need Rock Slide, Gyro Ball, Trick Room, and Protect.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to be great in that regard. The big thing is as well, you know, with the flinches, that's going to affect those counts. You don't want to be the one struggling first. Struggle's going to do minimal damage. And then you kind of run into a bit of a problem. So every time Luke flinches him, he actually kind of buys Eduardo a turn. We're now into lots of... Ooh! A chunky Gyro Ball there.
Ooh, was not a critical hit, but it does chip away. So that Stack Attacker on Luke's side looking dangerously close to getting into that red zone on its health bar. Goes for another Gyro Ball. I've got a feeling it might be out of the rock slides. And pushes it into the yellow zone. And it does manage to avoid. So kind of a win on that turn for Luke there. It'd be interesting to know how many turns of the game we're actually in.
Oh, that's a bad miss. I don't want to see the count of how many turns we are. The other gauge we haven't even touched on yet is the yaw time. I mean, it's not like it's taking them more than a second to decide this. But Luke's got a solid 25 second advantage at that turn. So if we can go for another 65 turns, Eduardo, you know, has to get it in within a second every time.
Oh!
The stack attacker on Luke's side starting to avoid things, getting a little bit closer on this one.
Exactly. Stack attacker, I believe, just avoided two rock slides in a row, goes for another one here, is going to be able to connect and does a little bit of chip, pushing it into that red zone. Yeah. So getting a little bit dangerous here for Luke. He might have to, you know, finally start thinking about that game two and what he's going to be adapting, because if you're both these players now, I don't think you necessarily want to be in this kind of endgame situation again for game two. So how are you going to get rid of your opponent's stack attacker?
Without something other than the stack attacker, I think would be my first port of call. It's definitely not the Pokemon you want against it. Luke just trick rooming over and over again here. Maybe an indication of where his power points are remaining in this game. He's got a long way to go to stage the comeback against Eduardo's stack attacker here, as it is just going to keep on attacking.
Yeah, taking it dangerously close to being KO'd. It just goes for another trick room here. So Luke really not using his opportunities to go on the offensive and start chipping away again at Eduardo's. Potentially he knows he doesn't have the attacking moves left to be able to sort of clean out this game.
Oh!
Goes for a protect though.
Luke's kept that one in the pocket for later, managing to kind of wear through these attacking moves. I think, you know, you need to be very cautious, maybe trying to throw Eduardo off, saving one, a little treat for later that he's been able to dive into here. Or it could just be his last move left.
Could this be the rock slide that takes it?
No!
It looks like we need more to connect onto Luke's stack attacker here.
Oh, it's going to be a slow one. And as you said, we've already spent a solid 27 minutes on this game. It will get this protect. Maybe Eduardo's going to keep attacking, and then he's going to be forced into a struggle early on. But
yeah, Eduardo,
I don't
though,
know.
He's starting to bring out these gyroballs. Maybe he's run out of his rock slides. You saw him go into another protect. But either way, just one move, I think, is going to be able to pick it up against Luke. The rock slide does connect, does pick up
there
the KO.
It is.
And game one ends after over 50% of the time. I mean, that was an intense finish for Stack Attacker. What an absolute trooper.
That was a long finish for Stack Attacker. That one took its time, but it was really, you know, minuscule amounts of health being worn down every single turn there. And that game, you know, you can't just give up in it if you're Luke. You know, you don't want to go down a game in this final series. Eduardo, so close. They've had plenty of time to think about game two. I'd imagine team preview can't be that lengthy. But overall, you know, it's been a tough one, and Luke's had a lot of time to be thinking about how to maybe not put himself in that position. That's what I'd be concerned about over the course of game two.
Yes, it's definitely not a ball position end game that you want in any game. So it's going to be interesting to see if these players will switch up their Pokemon. Interesting enough, they both benched one of their restrictors. There was no Xerneas, and Xerneas has been sort of the iconic Pokemon of the Oceania International Championship so far. And to not see it in that game one, it was probably a good thing considering there was Stack Attacker, but do you feel like these players might now want to leave the Stack Attacker at home? Like, it's had enough airtime?
Are you saying they had a harrowing experience and they don't want to be in that position again? Maybe. I think that's a very realistic consideration. And you've got to think about what your opponent does to mix it up as well. You know, do they bring the Serena, which makes your life a whole lot easier against it because of the weaknesses? And you don't want to be caught short with a Stack Attacker and, you know, just let it go down too early. It's such an influential Pokemon in these games. So we'll see what changes come through. The leads will be taking the field in this instance. A cheeky smile from both players, ready to see. Of course, Eduardo only needs to win this one to get the championship. Luke has to bring this one to himself to try and at least send us to the game three here.
Well, both players changing up their leads. You've got Smeagol and Lunala on Luke's side versus the Serena and Lunala on Eduardo's side. And I think you're right there, Adam. Bringing in that Serena is going to make your life a little bit easier against something like the Stack Attacker. It also will stop any priority from those Incineroars. And we could see previously that was causing a lot of trouble when you're able to switch in that Incineroar and get off the fake out, but nothing coming out except for this Z move at the moment. Oh my gosh, the menacing Moonrays Maelstrom is coming out from Lunala. He was brave, he clicked the button.
Yeah, I actually had a little chat with Luke about this. I said, do you feel like that's a good idea? And he went, it's not. It's not always, but you know, sometimes you've really got to risk it for the biscuit, and he's gone for it here. Lunala versus Lunala is not too glamorous a matchup, especially when you're the one with your Z move connecting.
Oh, I mean, Luke at the end of that Stack Attacker, Takataka off, let's just say, wants to come back with a vengeance, and this is certainly one way to do it. Removing one of Eduardo's restricted in turn one of game two just takes it straight off the field. Of course, it gives Eduardo the free switch into something else, potentially something like that Incineroar, but Smeargle going for the lovely kiss as well, does avoid. Serena also wanting to get on out of there and crucially breaking the focus sash by a huge amount of damage on that Smeargle.
Doesn't just break it, it just goes for the Smeargle at that point, yeah. But that, I think Luke, maybe thinking about the time there, if you want to have a quick game number two, that's the way to do it. Knock out Lunala turn one with menacing Moonray's Maelstrom.
Yes, there's going to be the special defense boost there for Smeargle and a defense drop. So nothing too concerning if you want to be going for those lovely kisses. Of course, you would want to potentially get an accuracy boost, particularly when you're facing down against the stack attacker. I think it's time to try and shut it down.
Yeah, I mean, the problem is right now it's going to be hard to shut down with the Incineroar partner that it's got right here. If you do want a Trick Room, which obviously against this kind of Smeargle and Lunala combination would be very, very strong indeed. Certainly something to consider. So, you know, Incineroar would probably be forced into targeting down the Smeargle, making sure it can't land a lovely kiss, and Lunala's not going to be able to do enough to stop any kind of potential move. Lunala's honestly not going to be able to do too much to either of the Pokemon over on Eduardo's side of the field. And I think Luke recognizing that, knowing the Smeargle's going to be in for a tough time, just trying to get a better position, get an Intimidate down, which is going to help out in the following turns.
Yeah, a great switch here from Luke. The Smeargle didn't have any boosts worth keeping. Just switch it out, bring it back in later, as the Fake Out does, of course, target down what was the Smeargle there. Leaving Lunala free, though, to go for a Moongeist Beam. Of course, you cannot fake out a Ghost-type. It's here kind of relatively unchecked on the field, and that is going into that stack attacker. Does do a good amount of damage, over 50%, so that is potentially a two-hit KO. A stack attacker goes for a Trick Room. Now, do you think it just wants to carry on from game one here and maybe click Rock Slide?
It's certainly interesting. Rock Slide would be great here for a couple of reasons. Of course, you're going to hit the Incineroar for super effective damage, and you're also going to break the Shadow Shield on Lunala. That makes it a whole lot easier for the Incineroar to pick it off. And then you could also just get the flinch on the Incineroar over on Luke's side of the field. Eduardo, though, saving his for later, probably a little bit concerned about the fake out. So it's going to be a question of if Luke fell for it, even though he'd already seen that there was a Serena in the back.
Yeah, I like this switch though from Eduardo, just in case Luke was packing something like the stack attacker in the back, get your Serena onto the field to threaten it going into the next turn. And of course, it also prevents that fake out from coming off, leaving stack attacker free to go for a rock slide. Gonna catch both Pokemon here, the Incineroar dealing super effective damage, but that Intimidate really paying off, and just gets a little chip on that Xerneas that switched in.
Yeah, it's certainly a good time to be bringing these Xerneas in on this one. I mean, not right now, but it came in and it protected Lunala, which I think is important. That's,
yes.
You know, I think when you look at the way this game's going, with the three remaining from Eduardo, you may as well bring in Xerneas early, let it buy some time, let it stall out some Trick Room turns, because then you can get back to a position, hopefully when Trick Room ends, where Lunala's able to play a little bit more. And, you know, as we saw the damage it did to Stack Attacker, really start picking things up that way. So I think Xerneas switching is definitely fine here. A little bit unfortunate for Luke that the Queenly Majesty does block his fake out. He does have to take some damage for his troubles. Could have gone a lot more aggressive calling that one. And Incineroar, after its failed fake out last turn, leaving the field in disgrace.
Yeah, Lunala jumping back in here, potentially going to fall victim to having its Shadow Shield broken. Actually, a double switch here from Luke. Going to be bringing that Smeargle back onto the field, potentially sacrificing itself.
Yeah, the Lunala switch could be interesting here, seeing what it can get out of this Serena. The Smeargle will fall to the Gyro Ball, which was, of course, heading towards the Xerneas for an easy knockout. The Stack Attacker starts with the Beast Boost.
Yeah, if this Serena has gone potentially for some kind of Fighting-type move into that other Pokemon, it would have had no damage against that Lunala, but instead just go straight for the U-turn, breaking that Shadow Shield crucially. So unfortunately, Lunala is now going to be more susceptible to damage going forward, and it gives Eduardo the opportunity to bring in his Incineroar once again, just to apply some more pressure to that Lunala that really can't touch it. But seeing as Luke has revealed his fourth and final Pokemon being that Xerneas, if you're Luke, you're really going to want to try and get rid of this Stack Attacker going forward.
Yeah, you have to get rid of the Stack Attacker as soon as possible, but you're not going to be afforded a great time to do it, especially with the combinations we have in play right now. Don't forget Trick Room's up. So anyone with a slower Incineroar does have an advantage in the fake out here, and your Shadow Shield is broken, so you can't afford to be taking attacks. you've got to be keeping it safe. And I think Luke may just have to look for a way to get through the kind of full extent of the Trick Room. One slip up though, and Stack Attacker can get some big damage down. Incineroar also, you know, very much able to try and get damage down at some point.
Stack Attacker actually switching out to reset its Intimidate and also stop a fake out coming up from the opposing Incineroar there. It's actually just going to shoot right back and bring in the Xerneas. So Luke potentially predicting that Stack Attacker wanted to jump out. Feels like it's a slightly safer environment for his Xerneas to come back in and start sort of going through some more of these Trick Room turns as Lunala does go for a Protect, saving itself from the knockoff coming out from Incineroar. And we know it has the Lunala EMZ, but it's still going to deal a huge amount of damage seeing as that Shadow Shield's broke.
Yeah, Shadow Shield's broken and it's not a favorite type matchup.
Oh, no.
Definitely not. Lunala forced into keeping itself safe there, and I think that switch in played around better by Luke. Obviously, the Serena switch in would have been interesting if he'd have tried to fake it out and then follow up with the Lunala. So, very smart play there by Luke to get that Incineroar out, not try and fake out in that turn. And once again, I mean, this Serena just coming in to stop the fake out, and now it's given that opportunity to just bounce back out with a U-turn. Both the Pokemon, both the restricted Pokemon on Luke's side of the field do not enjoy playing in this Trick Room mode. And I think he needs to get on the other side of that, let the Trick Room expire, and then he may be able to push on and get this game.
And having that Incineroar on the back is crucial when you are facing down against two physical attackers. Going to stop some damage coming off from the Serena as well as that Incineroar if it does want to go for another knockoff here, which it is going to do. Is it going to be? Ooh. Oh, it's actually going into that Incineroar, trying to knock off the Herb from that Xerneas, preventing a Geomancy in the future. But Incineroar on Luke's side, easily able to take that. Lunala having more chip and giving Eduardo the opportunity to bring back in his Stack Attacker.
Yeah, but I do like that play by Eduardo. You know, you saw the Xerneas there, maybe seeing if it was just going to try and stand there, because it wasn't too threatened by either of them. But if you knock off the power up when Tailwind or Trick Room expires, you then Geomancy. The big thing here, though, is Stack Attacker's come in. I'd be interested to see where this Moongeist Beam has gone based on the damage we know it already does.
Yeah, so this going into that Stack Attacker slot, which it very likely is, it can potentially pick up a two-hit KO. How much is it going to do? Stack Attacker survives on, I believe, only 6 hit points there. So that's crucial for Eduardo, keeping that Pokemon in play as Trick Room ends.
Yeah, and he's going to be hard-pressed to set it up again. That's just true. But right now, you know, he can't just rely on picking it up with something like the Lunala. If you leave the Lunala to knock out Stack Attacker, if you Moongeist Beam it again, for example, then the Incineroar is just going to hit you with a big knockoff, and that's something you really don't want to happen. I think it's going to be on Luke's Incineroar to try and apply enough pressure to the Stack Attacker to make sure that Trick Room doesn't come into play. He's managed to conserve his Xerneas in full, and Lunala not feeling too good about this one.
I completely agree with you there, Adam. You want to get rid of that Stack Attacker. You do not want Trick Room to go back up, and it being such a slow Pokemon outside of Trick Room, it is kind of easy pickings. I know it's gone for the Protect here on this occasion, but you potentially have the next turn to be able to go for it here. Incineroar going for the Flare Blitz though into that slot, but is there a knockoff potentially coming off?
Yep.
Yes, it is. He predicted the switch in here, or to be honest, you just go for that Lunala because it would have done super effective damage, and if Xerneas switches in, you get the item knocked off.
That was the safest play possible for him there, the Incineroar just knocking off on that side. But this Xerneas coming in really nice. Yeah, he's not going to be able to Geomancy, or he's able to. I don't know if I'd recommend
if
it without
brave.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd recommend it without a power-up. But now he's got access to Dazzling Gleam, and Dazzling Gleam able to pick up a Stack Attack and get good damage down on Incineroar. Definitely preferred to some of the options from the Lunala.
Yeah, the Stack Attacker, they're trying to go for a double Protect, but I feel like it used up all its Protect luck in game one. The critical hit,
that's the one he needed.
Yeah, exactly. Not too crucial on it there as the Dazzling Gleam picks up the KO against Stack Attacker, putting Xerneas in a little bit of a safer spot going forward. U-turn going to bring Incineroar into the back. It doesn't have to, you know, it won't be able to use its fake out, let's put it that way, as Serena's going to be forced in on Eduardo's side. But of course, keeping your fire type safe when there is a grass type on the opposing side of the field is going to be crucial going forward.
Yeah, I mean, the big thing here is he's going to be able to intimidate both of the opposing Pokemon as well a little bit later in the game. The Incineroar is going to go out for the Serena, but he's going to be forced to then bring in his Incineroar against the two special attackers. It's looks like this game pretty much done for, I'd say, with both Lunala and Stack Attacker gone on Eduardo's side. The big threats definitely removed. And Luke, you know, changing it up in this game and able to really make some good advantages for himself here. It's not over yet. Of course, there's still more turns to play. But it definitely looks like it's falling in Luke's favor this time.
Of course, and the one thing Eduardo has here is obviously the Serena's on his side of the field. He can go for a fake out, having just brought his intimidating Incineroar back onto the field. So he can stop the Xerneas from dealing out some good damage against both of these Pokemon. But it does leave the Lunala relatively unchecked. And like you mentioned as well, if Luke just wants to maybe switch out the Xerneas and stop it from taking any unnecessary damage, he can bring in that Incineroar, get Intimidate off against both of these Pokemon. As Eduardo cannot switch them out, they're going to be stuck with these attack drops. And that's exactly what we're seeing happening here.
Yeah, I mean, you want to come in, you want to just make them even easier to deal with. If you're not taking damage, that's fantastic news for you. And I think at this point, it's just going to be Luke just wearing them down. Obviously, the Incineroar is going to be able to try and fight back. That's going to be something that he is able to do here. And I don't think Eduardo is going to give it up. You can't just push it on that easily. We do see the attacks coming out now after the Intimidate. Power Whip. Not the best on Incineroar.
Yeah, Incineroar doesn't mind being hit by a few blades of grass. It is a fire-type Pokemon after all. The Incineroar on Eduardo's side is going to follow it up, though, with a Flare Blitz of its own. So double targeting into that opposing Xerneas, because ultimately, I know you said Geomancy's not the best without the Herb, and I don't think at this stage of the game it necessarily needs it. But just doubling into it to stop it potentially trying to be a little bit brave and get it up while it wasn't being heavily threatened is a good strategy on this side, leaving Lunala, though, relatively unchecked. And you could see how much damage that that Moongeist Beam did to Serena alone.
Yeah, I mean, that's just good information for him to carry on with as well. Serena showing its feint there, trying to make sure it gets a nice big attack in. Not really what you wanted there. Not the biggest amount of damage as Lunala just keeps on trucking in this game.
Yeah, it really looks like Luke has set himself up to take this game two and push it to a game three. Going into the Incineroar, though, this time, just wanting to chip away at it, potentially trying to get these Pokemon into something like a Dazzling Gleam range so that Xerneas can pop in from the back and just clean it up. But Serena being removed from the field, and it is going to be Incineroar sort of versus both of the Restricteds once again.
It's not a great time for Incineroar,
it's
really,
not,
is it?
No.
It's not its favorite pairing. We do finally get to see it land a knockoff on Lunala and not get the knockout there, even with the Shadow Shield broken. So you would have needed a little bit more even earlier on anyway. We do see Xerneas come in, and looks like we're going to be heading to game number three. Something curious to note, though, not long left on the clock.
No, there isn't. It's been a much quicker game two than it was game one, but there are only 8 minutes left on the clock in this grand final. So it is really going to come down to the wire, whether Luke is going to keep that that stack attacker on the bench, or whether Eduardo is going to maybe bench his. We'll have to find out and see whether these players are going to make any adjustments going into game three. They both dropped a Pokemon and picked a new one up for game two, but Adam, do you think that they're going to stick with the same four they brought for game two, or are they going to maybe shake it up again?
Not a chance. I think there's going to be mix-ups once again. I mean, it could just be a very different game. You know, do you just go for it with the Lunalas again in turn one? And that was a big thing for Luke.
It was very commanding in that turn one.
I mean, fortunate, but commanding as well. It puts him in the real driving seat. And I think if he goes for it again, it's going to be tough. Because, you know, you don't want to lose that one and then be in Eduardo's position for the duration of that game too.
Because once you've used your own Z-move, if the opposing Lunala still has access to theirs, you're going to be in constant fear of that going forward. Your own Lunala isn't going to be protected by having alleviated not only the opposing Ghost-type, but the Z-move using Ghost-type as well. So that's something both players will be looking to do. But it is going to be game three here at the Masters Grand Finals. It is really coming down to taking away that championship title.
Yeah, I mean, this has got to be one of the tightest finals we've seen in a while, and with the threat of that clock running down on them as well, any advantage you can get, such as a Pokemon advantage, with that Lunala getting early knockouts is going to be interesting. We're going to see a smile from Luke as the leads hit the field,
oh, wow,
and they are the same.
Yeah,
who's going for it?
There is some Smeargle Lunala action going on here, but there's so much at play. Are these Lunalas going to hit their Z-move? Is there going to be any redirection with Follow Me? Because of course, if you Follow Me and you Z-move, it's going to do nothing. You know, Ghost types cannot hit Normal types.
Both these players having a good chuckle about it. I think they know what they're both offering. They definitely do, and they're just saying, are you going to go for it? Or am I going to go for it?
Should
we both go for it?
Lovely kisses going on here as well.
I mean, there's always room for a lovely kiss. Maybe afterwards, depending on the outcome of the game.
Yeah.
But overall, you know, the threat of the Follow Me is huge. And being able to take away the menacing Moonraise Maelstrom is so key for both these players. Looks like Luke's not quite going for it this time, with a nice little protect there.
Yeah, going to go for a protect, potentially meaning that there could be a lovely kiss coming up from his partner Smeagol, as the Smeagol on Eduardo's side does go for the follow me. Psyshot coming out though, targeting down that Smeagol, going to take it down to its focus sash, but I do feel like lovely kiss is coming out here. It's going to go into that Smeagol, and it does connect. The follow me redirecting it, but what this crucially means is Eduardo does not have that redirection option going forward.
Now, Luke's put himself in such a good position for the next turn here. He knows his Lunala is going to be safe to try and fire off a menacing Moonray's Maelstrom. He's either going to land it into a protect, or he's going to be able to do damage to something on the way in. The Moody Boost coming through, though, and you seem pretty excited about that one.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that can help that Smeagol out in the long run. Potentially, once it wakes up and is able to start redirecting, it still has its Focus Sash intact, and it has just got a +2 evasion boost. So if Eduardo's maybe able to preserve his Lunala that is sitting very exposed now on the field, he can use that Smeagol later on to get the full positioning back in the way that he wants. But I think a very safe play here, switching out that Lunala and bringing in that Incineroar. Of course, the Intimidate, not really going to be too warranted here, but potentially you can get a fake out off onto that opposing Smeagol in the next turn, as long as Luke hasn't, you know, gone for a lovely kiss into that slot. But he hasn't, and we're going to see Xerneas jump onto the field.
Yeah, he's getting his restricted out early, knows he needs to start dealing damage as soon as possible with that clock still running perilously low. Menacing Moonrage Maelstrom has been selected by Luke. Head in the hand, not too keen on that switch in here. Still going to deal damage, that's nice, but it's not the amount of damage he wanted. I think he thought that Eduardo may have been buying in to that speed tie to see who gets it. So Luke showing his Z move early, using it up on an Incineroar of all things.
And of course, seeing as the switch from Eduardo was almost so, I don't want to say obvious, but it would have been a very straight play because Luke still could redirect away from his own Lunala, and Eduardo's was so exposed. Maybe Luke predicted that Eduardo would see that was so obvious, so would stay in and do the sneaky Z move back in return. But Eduardo did actually go for the switch here, leaving Incineroar in place to take the damage. Smeagol taking a nap though, still, and it gets an accuracy boost, so it's now at +1 accuracy, drops some attack, but it is not going to worry about that at all.
Yeah, I mean, the Smeagol's still asleep, and you do need to deal with it before it wakes up and starts causing absolute mayhem for the players, particularly on Luke's kind of side. You know, if he can get caught with big hits, that's going to be a problem. Fake out stopping this Xerneas for this turn, though.
Yes, Lunala here going to go for the Psyshock, though, targeting down into that sleeping Smeagol. Just wants to take it down to that Focus Sash. So potentially Xerneas, with a cheeky little Dazzling Gleam in the future, will be able to pick up the KO. Smeagol's still sleeping, though. It does still have its +2 evasion, but is it going to keep that for a while? Accuracy rising up to +3, and it does still keep its evasion. So +3 accuracy, +2 evasion. Once it wakes up, it can start lovely kissing all over the place. But Adam, that timer is dangerous. Low.
Yeah, it's so, so low. We're going to have to see, you know, we obviously have a tiebreaker situation, and I honestly think we're going to be hitting it. The timer is really allowing maybe one or two turns before we get towards the end of the game, as Luke decides to save his Lunala for maybe those +3 turns we play.
Yeah, Incineroar going to jump back in here. Just going to fire off some Intimidate against that Incineroar, crucially, to negate some of the damage that it could be dealing
out to his
Pokemon. But it connects onto the Smeagol, that Dazzling Gleam, meaning that Luke is one Pokemon up. And with the turn time running down, this could be crucial towards the end game of this situation. Eduardo going for a U-turn, getting his own Incineroar on out of there.
Yeah, I mean, that Smeagol getting knocked out is a real big issue, I think, for Eduardo, because he loses one of his kind of threats. In that, how he can try and shut down, you know, the threat of being able to avoid moves and hit like lovely kisses was a big deal. Of course, bringing in Stack Attacker is good. It's not going to be too easy to knock out if you're Luke, but the Pokemon count advantage sits with Luke Katale now, and that's a big deal as we approach potential tiebreakers.
Very true, but you have to be careful if you're that Xerneas right about now. The Gyrable from the opposing Stack Attacker is still going to be heavily threatening. And of course, Incineroar here, that's just jumped in for Eduardo, is going to have access to that Fake Out. So you do have to make sure that you are preserving your Pokemon well. Potentially wants to switch in something from the back just to take that damage. But it's going to be interesting to see how he's going to adjust. Maybe just go for a Protect and play defensively. But Eduardo actually going to switch out his own Incineroar, bring back in that Lunala.
Yeah, that Lunala coming in with the Shadow Shield still in play. That means the Fake Out will not connect. A good turn there if you are Eduardo. Wants to make sure that he doesn't get too much damage down. Stack Attacker will just Rock Slide at the end of the turn, though. That Lunala did get caught with a Dazzling Gleam and a lot of damage down.
Yeah, Incineroar taking a huge amount of damage from that. Xerneas coming out of the turn relatively unscathed, though, however. Not going for any Geomancy boosts here, just kind of going into the Dazzling Gleams and just trying to chip away at some of Eduardo's Pokemon. Lunala, of course, getting its Shadow Shield broken as well. That could be quite crucial.
Look at this timer. It's so dangerously
20
low.
20 seconds.
Yeah, we do see Eduardo's locked his moves in. We are going to see if Luke has gone for it as well. So it's going to be interesting to see when this turn starts. It's going to be so, so tight depending on who gets this one. The turn has begun.
Yeah, Xerneas jumping out here, going to be preserved for later on, and Smeargle comes in to potentially sacrifice itself. Lunala also going on the defensive and going for a Protect, does not want to take any damage from this opposing Incineroar that does go for a Snarl. So a great Protect there from Lunala, just stopping itself getting damaged even further and having its special attack reduced, because going forward, it's going to have to deal out as much damage as possible. Stack Attacker, though, going for the Trick Room.
Yeah, and we have got confirmation. This turn we've just seen was considered turn zero. That's what the judge called. So we play one, two, and three more turns, similar to our friends in the trading card game, of course. That's how we're going to get down to this. The review is, when we get to the end of those three turns, it's going to come down to the number of Pokemon they have remaining. If there is an exact match there, potentially a 3-3 or a 2-2, we have to start looking at the hit points here.
This is where, as a player, your complete mindset changes. It's not about winning the entire set. It is about keeping your Pokemon healthy and trying to take down some of the opposing Pokemon. Ooh. Smeargle goes for a Wyguard, though, so if the Stack Attacker has gone for something like a Rock Slide, it's not going to be dealing any damage, but it goes for the Gyro Ball. Eduardo was throwing his head back in relief. He is able to match up the numbers here. It is now three apiece. Both Smeargles have gone down. A Stack Attacker is able to get a defense boost as well. I think Luke congratulating that play as the Z-move comes off as well. So Eduardo, crucially, in this turn one, takes down two Pokemon.
Yeah, that's going to be a Pokemon advantage over to Eduardo. He's been behind for a good portion of this game now, but where it matters, he manages to make the right call, not go for a Rock Slide, finally pick off that Smeargle down on its Focus Sash, and land the menacing Moonray's Maelstrom right where he needs it. It's going to be a big ask in the remaining two turns for Luke to be able to swing this one back.
This is the last time we will see this animation over this weekend, and it is going into a Lunala. This is the perfect target for this Z move, and it picks up the very clean KO. So now the battle stakes, you have got three Pokemon remaining for Eduardo and two for Luke.
Yeah, it's the Pokemon advantage that he really, really needs, because that's the first kind of metric we use in the tiebreaker. Luke forced to send out his final two Pokemon, a heavily damaged Xerneas facing down a Stack Attacker with Gyro Ball, and of course a damaged Incineroar as well. We may not even need to get to the tiebreakers.
I mean, you could go for the Fake Out here into that Stack Attacker and just stop it going for any Rock Slides or Gyro Ball, but that Lunala still has relatively high health, and as the Xerneas has no Geomancy, you're not going to be picking up any clean KOs with a Moonblast here. So as long as Eduardo can play relatively defensively, maybe do some good switches here. Switching that Incineroar for your Lunala, go for a Protect on the Stack Attacker, for example, he's going to be able to take this title.
Yeah, and that's all he really needs to do is just make a couple of simple plays to get through this one, keeping himself safe from the Fake Out, making sure that Luke isn't able to knock something out as we approach the final turns of the game.
Yeah, double Protect there from Eduardo, doing exactly what he needs to be doing and just playing defensively. Luke as well, going for the Protect on his opposing Xerneas as Incineroar goes for the Snarl. Potentially that could have been an opportunity for Luke to go for some damage, but it also does burn out his Protect for the final turn.
Yeah, I mean, he has no Protect on Xerneas, so I think Eduardo's just going to pick it off and crown himself basically the international champion here in Melbourne. If Luke had held onto that Protect, it could have been a little bit different. There is going to be a switch from Eduardo here into his Incineroar. I think Luke has one option, and it's not the most reliable.
No, that is very true. You know, the Intimidate coming out here onto the opposing Incineroar, but keeping that Lunala nice and safe in the back as Stack Attacker does go for the Gyro Ball. How much is it going to do? It picks up the KO. This means that Eduardo has the Pokemon advantage going into the end of this turn. Stack Attacker gets a little beast boost, and who would have thought it after that game one? Stack Attacker here cleaning up and taking the victory for Eduardo.
Yeah, this is the final turn. The Stack Attacker doesn't even take anywhere near enough damage from the Flare Blitz. And with that in mind, you know, the confirmation there that it's three Pokemon on Eduardo's side with just the one remaining on Luke's, that's the final turn of gameplay here. And Eduardo will be your winner.
Yeah, you can see the judges there on the players' cam just talking through the final sort of conditions of this endgame situation, but both these players know how it stands at the moment, and Eduardo will be. You can see it there. There's the handshake. Eduardo is your 2019 Oceania International Champion.
Yeah, they were just making sure everything was as intended, making sure it definitely was cricket down here in Australia. And a nice embrace from the players as Eduardo making the best of that really tight end game there, finally able to carve out an advantage in the Pokemon numbers and win on the first tiebreaker condition.
Yeah, that was an absolutely incredible game. We kind of saw it all there, Adam. In that game one, it dragged on with those two Stack Attackers really fighting it out. And both these players had to recognize an endgame situation, and they went into a kind of autopilot mode a little bit just to take it through into game two. Game two, they switch it up a little bit, show their expertise in how they can adjust their Pokemon going into another situation, took it to a game three. And then we saw in that game three, risks were made and plays were played, and we got a winner.
Yeah, I mean, the big play, I think, in game three, don't really want to go into it too much, but that Incineroar switch in, definite change up from game two when you lost the Lunala. The Incineroar switch in, a lot better from Eduardo.
Thank you, Lou and Adam. I'm here with your 2019 Oceania International Champion, Eduardo Cunha. You did it. You made it through the round. How do you feel right now?
I feel amazing. It's such a rewarding experience. Just I worked so hard towards this and get the win. I've been trying for the past 3 years to, you know, be able to come out on top on an international, and I finally made it, and I'm really, really happy.
Well, congratulations. It was definitely well earned. I want to sort of take a moment to talk about your preparation for this match, because, you know, we talked about it a lot on the stream, but the six Pokemon that both you guys had were identical. So what was your thinking coming into this game?
Yeah, I thought that Smeargle would be, you know, obviously very crucial in not only blocking the these lovely kisses, but also pressuring the Lunala not to go for the Z move and being able to redirect it. So my initial plan was actually just go Lunala, Smeargle, and I felt like I had answers to every single combination it could bring. Stack Attack, I felt like, was really important in my matchup because we knew going into the tournament that we had to be very careful when dealing with the Pokemon because, you know, we only have Serena and Lunala to really touch it. So I knew that you wouldn't really be able to bring Serena. And even if he did, I could play some mind games on iJump Kick with Lunala. So I felt comfortable bringing the Stack Attack, and you know, it ended up being a crucial member of the strategy in the games that I won. It was tough. There were many mind games in play, many speed ties as well, and I'm glad that not many came actually into play. So yeah, in the end, I was expecting it to be much more luck dependent than it ended up being. I think Luke played really well, and I'm glad that I managed to come out on top.
I mean, you talk about Stack Attacker. There was about 20, 30 turns where they were both just duking it out on the field. How do you play through a situation like that?
Yeah, I knew that since we both struggled with Stack Attacker, as long as I dealt more damage to his Stack Attacker, I'd be able to win the end game. Obviously, there are a lot of factors to take into account because every time we get flinched, we don't get to waste power points. So basically what happens is we don't get to as close to struggling. And you know, we both kind of wanted to attack, but not at the same time because I felt like I had enough rock slides to be able to KO the Stack Attacker naturally. But at the same time, I couldn't walk into, with rock slides into protect because then I wouldn't have enough rock slides. But at the same time, as long as I was eating the rock slides into protect, I wasn't flinching him. So I still had the struggle win condition. It was very complicated to make sure I wanted to attack. We had a lot of mind games going on then as well. We went for Trick Room a lot of times and it literally didn't matter. Given that we both have the same speed. So.
Yeah, well, speaking of mind games, I mean, those last three turns of game three as well must have been very tense. What was your thought, you know, approaching the time end of time and then going into those three turns?
Actually, to be honest, the time just flew by. I really didn't notice that 50 minutes had been gone. I considered in game two going for the time, considering the timer going to my strategy, you know, not necessarily playing for it, but being afraid of like playing it slowly because, you know, I could lose because of the timer. So that being said, of course, my mindset in the end was that when I was told that timer had been reached, I just had to get have more Pokemon alive than him. And the fact that he had just brought in the Smeargle, and I know he doesn't have Protect, I could just double target that slot, get a KO. Incineroar wasn't really pressuring me with a KO there, so it was fairly I was fairly comfortable getting that KO. His switch into Lunala was very clever because had I not gone for the Moon for the Z move, then he would have been in an amazing position. But I'm glad that I managed to call it right, and that was definitely decisive.
All right, well, congratulations once again. Now that you're international champion, anybody you want to shout out or say hi to back at home?
Yes, I have so many people. All of my friends that are here in the crowd, obviously the Gazpacho, they're some of the best people I know, and they've helped me so much. My teammates from some team tournaments we play, like the Classius and the Symbians. Shout out to Boyama Boy. And yeah, all my friends, everyone that's been supporting my family, of course. That's all, basically. Thank you all very much.
All right, well, thank you so much for your time. I'll let you go enjoy that win. Adam and Lou, please take it away.